Waiting for Jyoti to join from Care for Air India. Hello, everyone. We're going to be starting our Insta Live session soon, waiting for Jyoti to join. And just to let you know that we are also on, we're on your connection is paused, Jyoti, but I'm guessing it's just a matter of time. Some Wi-Fi issues. She is in Goa. So we'll give her a few more minutes to join back. Just to reiterate, we are on Insta Live and also live on Backstage and taking questions. We'll be talking to Jyoti Pande Lavakare right now. She's with the Care for Air India, working on air pollution for the last 7 years, I believe, and her new book is out called Breathing Here is Injurious to Your Health. So we'll be talking about that whenever Jyoti can join back. We have a few more minutes. So then, I'll talk about the book. Breathing Here is Injurious to Your Health. Is it showing a mirror image? I'm guessing. Oh, there you are, Jyoti. I was just showing a book.
Hi. Good. Hi. And I think even at backstage, there seems to be, I don't know if I've got on there as well. Anyway.
Yeah. Hello. You're looking like a proper Goan already.
And getting away from air is a relief, you know, it's such a relief, and you know how bad it is, and you know that we're all stuck there, so whenever we get a chance to just breathe a little bit pure air, just gotta grab it and go.
Yeah, no, it takes years off, you know, just to get out and be active, and you know, you want to be out, you want to be walking around, which don't have that up here in North India.
Yeah.
So let's start. So again, you know, we're here talking to Jyoti from with Care for Air. We're on backstage live and on Insta, and we're talking about Jyoti's book called "Breathing Here Is Injurious to Your Health: The Human Cost of Air Pollution and How You Can Be the Change." So buy it, everyone. It's awesome. You have Jaipur Lit Festival, and great to see that, you know, whenever people who are not in the typical kind of environment space are talking about air pollution, whether it is art galleries or, you know, in the literature, it's so nice to kind of bring people in who normally wouldn't be talking about air pollution. So fabulous. Jyoti, since you are in Goa, first thing I'm going to talk to you about is the exodus of people. Everybody either wants to leave places like Delhi or, you know, other cities which have really bad air pollution, or they have left it. And you're in Goa right now. So let's talk about that. And, you know, all our friends, so many of our friends have left. People who really were working on air pollution, who really understood the cause, to see them leave. So go ahead.
So for me, I think for those of us who are aware and we know how bad air quality in North India is, and also those of us who have gotten over that hump of denial, which even I must admit I went through, because whenever you find something that is so serious like this, and in my case, it ended up being a personal story with lung cancer, which the doctors said was probably triggered by the dirty air. She'd been breathing all her life. She lived in North India all her life. You know, something that was very theoretical ended up becoming very real for me. And I realized, well, this is what's happened before. It was probably happened to my children and all of us. And the reason, one of the reasons, you know, we decided that we do want to make the move out of Delhi, because, you know, we did choose to come to Delhi even when we were living outside India, because this was home for us. And for both of us, I was born and raised in Delhi, and my husband also lived his life in Delhi. And for us to make that choice to come back to a city, at that time I didn't know how polluted it was. And once I discovered that, that was, I think, to me, the turning point. Because first, of course, like most of us, I went through denial that no, it can't be so bad. And, you know, maybe there are pockets of Delhi which aren't so bad. We always try and find solutions. And it's always a case of fight or flight, right? So the exodus that you're talking about, I started noticing it, and I've sort of tried to encapsulate it in my book, was first mainly with the expats, because they were the first to realize, you know, because they'd lived in other parts of the world where the skies were blue, they knew what clean air smelled and felt and tasted like. And I think most of us who've just grown up with dirty air don't even know what clean air and blue skies, real blue skies, not blue skies of Delhi, which are kind of a light grey blue, really look like and smell and feel like. So I think for most of us, since we don't know, and even for me, because I'm living in California where I had seen blue skies at a later point in my life, I was also a young mother of young children at that time, it suddenly became very important for me to have my children and us there. So even today, the reason, again, like I was saying, I'm in Goa, is because I had a very bad attack of COVID. And I also realized that, breathing bad also compromises our entire health and our lungs in ways we don't realize. You know, there was a recent report that I read where there are areas in Mumbai which have very high air pollution, and those are also the areas which have very high rates of COVID. So that linkage has been there right from the beginning. I have, again, in chapter 14 of my book, written about the linkage between COVID, higher rates of COVID, worse attacks of COVID when you live in more polluted cities. So, or doesn't only have to be any which is more polluted. In fact, they trace this right from Milan, where the original sort of outbreak of COVID had found, and they found that even there, the initial most early research was done by the scientists, and again, it's there in the book. So I think what I'm really trying to say is, for most of us, if we can afford to get out of areas of bad pollution, then we try that. But for a lot of us, that isn't an option. And that is what makes it very inequitable, and it makes it very unfortunate, because for a lot of us, we can't do it, you know. And for those of us who can do it, may not even want to. For example, I don't want to leave the city where I've grown up, where my friends are, where my relatives are, my family is, but because I have to make this very difficult choice, you know, gotta do it because health first. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but that's really what I'm gotta just go where you have best health, because health is wealth in every
that's way. That's what's coming now. One of your other interviews, I think they were saying that, you know, I mean, this is what's coming for all of us. At some point, we won't have a choice. You know, we're thinking of all these people are leaving, but I'm just waiting for one of my children to have something, right? The moment they get some kind of attack of something, bronchitis, something, I'll be on the first flight out, you know? So we're just waiting for it to get that bad that we also will have to leave, you know? And all cities, I mean, all over India. So speaking of this, you know, in your book, you talk about how, you know, you lived in the States and then you moved back. And so you had this very, and as a journalist also, you know, you had this very interesting circle of friends where a lot of people were Indian, a lot of people were expats. And it was very kind of a clear division. The Indians were all denying that there was, this was pre-2015, right? So nobody was really talking about it. So everyone was in denial, and the expats were like, oh my God, it's awful, because they had come from abroad and they had seen. And you were kind of on the outskirts, like kind of bemused at this. how could this whole group think that there's no air pollution and this whole group think that there is? And so, you know, wanted to talk to you about how, you know, there's three, I think of it as three kinds of people. Either you, you're in denial that there's, you know, there's no air pollution. If it's there, I don't want to think about it, or you leave, or, you know, you stay and you say, okay, I'll stay and fight. I'll stay and do something about it. And we all have these moments that, you know, kuch to karna chahiye, you know, and at that time you kind of pledged yourself that I'll do something. So I wanted to talk to you then, how do you facilitate that, okay, yes, everyone is talking about, you know, there's some big air pollution moment right now, everyone's talking about it. How do you facilitate taking all these kind of pledges and as activists, you know, putting it into action? So it's not that people are just saying, okay, kuch to karna chahiye. But okay, kuch karna hai, you know, here you go, do this, sign this, and get this done. So how, you know?
So firstly, like I've said in my book, I myself, I didn't set out to be an activist. And I'm sure many of us don't want to really be activists. We want to get on with our lives. We want to do our stuff, write our books, do our jobs, take care of our children, follow our careers. But what happens is, when you don't get what is a very basic fundamental human right, you know, clean air, clean water, these are not things we should have to fight about. These are things we should just have, right? Even, I mean, if your country's GDP is, you know, there's a time when India's GDP was being projected to be 10%, 11%. Now, of course, because of COVID and all, it's come down. But there was a time when we were saying, okay, India is going to be the big economy. If you don't have these basic things like clean air and clean water, development and growth, you know, there's a difference between just following economic growth, which again is a human construct, and then looking at it from the point of development, which includes healthcare, education, quality of life, you know, happiness, all those kind of things. And I think that's where we have gone wrong, where we are following the wrong indicator in some way. And, you know, again, going back to your question, some people tend to leave and away and, like I said, flight, versus some who want to fight it and they feel this problem is so enormous. How do I fight it? So that's a very interesting question, because even for me, I don't know really what I as an ordinary individual. So So, you know, you have to see what your skill strengths are. Mine were writing, so I tried to collect all the information that I could. Go, like you said, one set of friends who were like, oh God, why did you come back? Are you crazy? You have young children. These were my expat friends mostly. Then I had the friends whom I had grown up with, who had gone to school with, who were going like, oh, forget it. You've turned into a foreigner. You know, come back, become a Desi again. This is how we live and nothing is wrong with us. Our lungs are made of steel. So, you know, as a journalist, all I could do was really get into the research. And when I got in there, what I found was shocking, that there was so much information. And it was not just that air was bad and it was killing us, but that connection between air quality and health harm had not really been examined enough, I felt. You know, it was there. We had really good research. It's there in the silos, in the labs. But unless science is not able to be simplified, amplified, understood, used for the betterment of all of us human beings, personally, I feel that is really not worth it for going on doing experiments in little labs which are not going to get out and make the human life better. Doesn't work for me. So I think I just looked at what my skill strength was and tried to sort of work with that. Get Care for Air, who's a lawyer with the Supreme Court. He tried to work with what skill strength was, you know, as a Supreme Court lawyer, he filed the Supreme Court trying to get fireworks banned, a whole bunch of other things. So air pollution is a very complex science, and it's also it's complex, but also in some ways easy, because we don't, as ordinary people, we don't have to know everything that goes into creating that air pollution. What we want to know is what are the solutions and how can we implement those. So I think to say that what you and I do, there are things that we can do at an individual level, there are things that we can do at a corporate level, and there are things that the government should and, you know, must do. So at an individual level, of course, yes, we can take public transport, we can segregate our garbage, we can start becoming very aware. Firstly, the first step to anything is awareness, right? And then ask for accountability. Use our
you close in a bit.
Who are in this field, how fashion also is a very highly polluting industry. So, you know, do I really need that next, that, you know,
Jyoti, I'm going to interrupt you.
Who's a small?
Could you move to somewhere with better Wi-Fi? You're being interrupted a lot. You're going in and out. Also, your volume. You're sitting right next to your Wi-Fi. I'm wondering if it's better if you go outside for the 4G.
Okay. So then I'll have to go out to the main road. And that's one of the problems.
Okay, wow. Well, no, I guess let's keep doing this. Maybe just hold the phone closer to you, so at least when you're there, your volume is a little higher, because this is also being podcast, right?
Right.
So, okay. There you go.
Okay. Is it better?
Yeah, much better. I mean, better in terms of the volume for sure, but hopefully it will not go in and out as much. All right, so... I wanted to talk some more about the book. I love the name. Breathing here is injurious to your health. And, you know, I love the connections it makes with smoking, because, you know, you buy a packet of cigarettes, you see this horrible photo of, you know, some kind of cancer or throat or whatever. And I feel like, you know, who shows us this photo every time we breathe in, you know? If somebody flies into India, there should be a big sign on the airport saying that, listen, you know, before you step out of your plane, you should know what you're breathing. So I love the name. I also love the index, where you've kind of made it into a sentence, you know, forget India's, it's very cool. There's another thing I liked in your book is how you took a very personal narrative, which was, you know, your family struggling with air pollution. Of course, when you started your struggle, your mom, you know, you started your struggle for clean air. And then later your mom developed lung cancer, which kind of underlined a lot of the struggle and the motivation for it. but also, you know, your children struggling to play sports at school. And then in there, you wove in the solutions, the sources of air pollution and the kind of solutions that have been tried and that you've been at the forefront of trying. You talk about, yeah, when you're talking to your waste collector, you talk about waste management. When you're driving to Banaras, you talk about the chula burning. You know, so I love how that's been kind of sprinkled in. And that's something I think people, whenever we're talking about solutions, let's talk about solutions. Let's not talk about the problem. Let's focus on solutions. But there's so many solutions that all have to be kind of implemented simultaneously. And it gets really overwhelming, right? And then people are blaming each other, but what about cars? What about firecrackers? So how do you talk about solutions? I mean, should we as citizens focus on solutions? Should we focus on pressuring the government? Should we be helping the government? How should the kind of philosophy of addressing this problem go, according to you?
So I think air pollution is like a hydra-headed monster. It's literally like the Ravan of today, you know. So there are at least 10 to 12 different sources of pollution. And so each one of those heads has to be cut off. And we can't have a system of exactly what you said, whataboutery, what about this? So when you ban firecrackers, the Firecrackers Association will say, no, but what about vehicles? They are so polluting. When you try and get, address the vehicular pollution problem, the car manufacturing lobby will say, but, you know, what about garbage? So you can't actually take just one head off. You have to attack all the heads at the same time. And again, the reason, like you said, why I brought forward my own family story is because it's every family's story, Sherry. You have children, others who have children. We all want to protect our children. Warrior moms, whether you're a warrior mom and you are labeled as a warrior mom, or you're just a mom, you're still a warrior mom. You may not call yourself a warrior mom. Every mom is a warrior mom. And if you tell a mother that your children are being attacked by an invisible killer, that mother is not going to let that child be affected, or they will do their best. Whether they feel overwhelmed or not, they are going to go out there and fight it. And it's not just here, it's anywhere in the world. So I think it's very important to tell the personal story, because that's how people understand a complex in a simplified way. To a mother who is busy with her children, with her job, taking care of her family, she's going to say, look, I don't have time for all this right now. But if I tell a mother, your child is, your husband may get a stroke because of this, you yourself may get breast cancer because you're smoking this air, not breathing this air, then that mother will say, okay, I'm going to find the time to change something like this. And I think that is why it's important to tell stories. It's important to create around air pollution, you know. There was an exhibition called Breathless, where there was even a song created, Dhua Dhua, if you remember. You know, so we have to embed it in every aspect of our lives so that the government and the people who are making decisions realize that we're not going to stop until we get this basic right to breathe clean air. There's no question, because it's, you know, I'm reading this book by this author called James Nestor. It's called Breath. And it talks about how breath can actually transform the human body. And once you read that, you realize I've just started reading it. I'm on chapter 3. He has assumed that the air that you're breathing is clean, because people take it for granted in other countries. We're the only ones who have to really, people in countries that are not so developed, where they're chasing after that growth, in that green light of growth, we are the only ones who can't take clean air for granted. We should be taking it for granted. So I think it's very important, and things that, you know, all of us, you guys are doing, other grassroots nonprofits are doing. Some are creating awareness, some are create better policy, some are trying to push this through government channels. I think all of us together, that's the only way we'll get any. So we really have to all focus on our skills. Okay, what is it that I can do at a personal level, at a corporate level, at a government level? What is it that we can do to get this very basic level? Because otherwise, we're all smokers from day one. You know, your newborn baby, your elderly grandmother, aunt, we're all smoking away from morning to night without even the fun of it, you know. You don't even have that fun of taking a puff, like a smoker will enjoy that puff, or, you know, but we don't enjoy it, and we're still smokers. Our lungs are still smokers' lungs. I know that I was hit by COVID, and the reason I had to come and sort of try and recover out here, I still, there are times I still feel breathless, is because I'd lived in Delhi for 10 years, in the last 10 years, and also from, you know, as a young child, and my lungs are in great shape, even though I'm not a smoker. So I think those are important things we need to look at. If you offer, just tell me today, if somebody said, look, I'm going to give you $10 million, but I'll also give you breast cancer with it. I don't think anybody would make that choice to say, okay, I think I'll take the 10 million plus breast cancer. No way. Because, and that choice is not, you know, people don't realize that's a choice we're making today. So I think the minute people realize through our story, through art, through anything, when people realize that, they're going
to... Yeah, you know, earlier, like last year when COVID had just become like a big thing in China, we were just reading about it. And there was a study saying that people who smoked had worse outcomes with COVID. And I remember Jay's this thing. Now, he had shared this, and I said, okay, oh gosh, we're all screwed, you know. If smokers have this problem, and we're all smokers, you know, what's going to happen to us? And gosh, it turned out to be prophetic. I mean, so that's, I guess, I mean, we'll take questions from audience, but I know you had a chapter on COVID and air pollution, and how, you know, there's many different kinds of linkages between air pollution and COVID, how it spread, and also why it affects us more when our lung is already damaged. So could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. In fact, I'll just read it out from my book, from the chapter. So it's in chapter 14, page 301. So it says, so what I've written is, in short, every day emerging research shows new linkages between air pollution and respiratory viruses such as SARS-CoV-2, weaving them together in a denser, tighter web. COVID-19 is a new disease, but recent research already shows three direct interlinkages. One, that people are more likely to contract respiratory diseases like COVID if they live in polluted areas, because high levels of pollution lower the body's natural defenses against airborne viruses. Two, that COVID will affect people more severely if they suffer from pre-existing pollution-triggered diseases. And three, the current levels of air pollution that COVID patients are exposed to will add to the severity of the disease, leading to greater chances of hospitalization and death. A fourth interlinkage, that microparticulates act like tiny Ubers that SARS-CoV-2 viruses hitch a ride to proliferate the spread of the disease, is still in the process of being validated. Now, this was written last year when it was still in the process of being validated. Since then, it has been validated. And now, even the WHO has said that, you know, COVID is spread through aerosol and all of that. So what I'm trying to say is that this research, which emerged earlier and which I tried to capture in my book, is now, in fact, being even more, you know, there's even more research done on this. And it is absolutely, nobody is now doubting this at all. So in that sense, we should be very afraid, you know, very, very afraid, because areas that have very high air pollution will have people who are more susceptible, more vulnerable. And therefore, you know, we will have a much higher, I would say the outcomes are much worse for a country like ours, where the rates of air pollution are high. 98% of our country has high levels of air pollution, which go much beyond the WHO level.
Yeah, you know, you went in and out a little bit, so I just want to make sure that everyone got what you said, that air pollution particles, you know, the ones we studied, the PM2.5, act as an Uber for COVID virus. And I thought that was a very cool kind of way to think about it, that they just hitch a ride. And that also explains a lot of times, you know, we've had on our various groups, we've had people saying that, I didn't go anywhere, I didn't do anything, I didn't meet anybody. How did I get COVID in the second wave? And if it's airborne and you have particles, you know, that can go anywhere, then that kind of explains it. Then you can't protect yourself, you know. You, there's not much you can do, even with masks and vaccines and everything. So,
right? I mean, you're not wearing a mask in your own home. You're thinking you're safe, you're in your home, but these little Ubers are heading straight towards you with the COVID virus sitting on it. So you don't have to go out. They are coming to you because there's so much pollution in the air. So yeah, you're right. I mean, just sitting at home doesn't feel safe anymore in countries with such high levels of air, which is pretty sad. Like, if you can't be safe in your own home, then where are you going to be safe?
And now, if all the predictions say third wave will overlap with Delhi pollution, so we all need to have our plan of exodus in place, whoever can. My goodness, it's going to be a nightmare. I hope that
affected. But children will be more affected in the third wave. That's another theory that's going around. So it is scary to know that, you know, you can't even be safe in your own homes because these aerosol particles with the high pollution and the high PM2.5 that our winters in the north of India bring us, they're going to be just zeroing down on straight at us. So really, I mean, the only solution is to bring down air pollution and particulate matter. And our governments and even our corporate, you know, there is such a chance right now with electric vehicles, for our corp, you know, for like say the Olas and the delivery, you know, there's a lot of delivery happening at times when there are lockdowns, right? Because we all need stuff at home. Now, if the corporates like your Swiggies and Zomatos and your Olas and whatever, if they decided that we are going to just turn our fleet completely electric, as you know that almost 80% of vehicular pollution comes from our stroke engines of our two-wheelers, etc., that are out there on the streets, which have that dirty fuel they use, and if they could just be converted into electric, and if the corporates took that call and made a pledge and said, okay, my fleet is going to go 100% electric by 2023 or whatever, what they should make that commitment. We don't need a CSR and this and that. We need that commitment, and it can be profitable as well, because once you do that, the kind of activity increase when less people are the productivity of a neighborhood also grows up. It's an imputed cost that is not counted very often. These are very important things that corporates also need to step up and say, okay, this is what we're going to do. We commit to it. Nobody is forcing us. It isn't that we are going to do it, because my family, my wife and and whatever also suffer. We all need to get together and hold hands.
Yeah, I know the one thing we have in common is both of us have EVs, and I just, you know, the other day I was in front of one of these huge thermal power plants. You know, I was thinking that, okay, you know, I may not pollute on the road, but here's these power plants, and they're also refusing to, you know, to meet the emissions norms, and we're struggling with that. But that's so invisible. But you know, but that's something that can be done. You know, that's a solution that can be done fairly easily, and that makes EVs a lot cleaner if we can have this kind of. I'm back. We're at 6 o'clock. We'll start taking questions now. And if anyone has any questions, or is there anything particular you'd like to kind of talk about? Anyone? You know, I wanted to talk about a little bit about air pollution. How, you know, we talk about the deaths caused by air pollution, we talk about the diseases caused by air pollution, but there's also, you know, the things that we live with, the things that, you know, like your mental health. There was a study recently saying that men's sperm counts go down because of air pollution, and cognitive scores go down by some 3 or 4 points, you know, IQ. And these are things that we live with, and if you think about, okay, my IQ is down by 3 points, it may not be a big deal, but the whole country's IQ is down by 3 points, you know? I mean, that has to translate to huge numbers, right? And I think in your book, you mentioned something like an 8% drop in GDP because of air pollution.
Yeah.
I mean, why didn't GDP take this into account, you know?
Sorry?
The costs are being borne by us, you know, of air pollution. But the price of fixing air pollution is much lower than the cost being borne by us. So, you know, why doesn't the GDP take this into account when we're talking about it?
So that's the thing. That's what I think people need to understand. And this is such a hidden problem, you know. Firstly, people don't understand. So, you know, this is a challenge I throw out to everybody at every talk that I have. In any family, and I will, you know, I even here, I just arrived here in Goa a couple of days ago, and I've already met people who are telling me that, you know, they had pneumonia last winter, somebody's had bronchitis. The number of people who are suffering from respiratory diseases in our country, you know, and elderly people will go into, you know, somebody will have a fall. You'll always, somebody will have a grandfather or an uncle who had a fall, went into hospital, but then didn't die because of the fall or a break of a bone or anything, because they got pneumonia or they got, you know, a lung failure. And all that is because they are already, you know, our lungs are made in a way that even like when I got COVID, I was told that almost 50% of my lungs were damaged because of COVID. And God has given us two lungs. God has given us lungs where, you know, most of the damage done to our lungs can be reversed. And that's why we keep surviving and surviving. But there are people at some point when you're older and you've lived through hundreds and thousands and millions of breaths of bad air, at some point your lungs are going to pack it in. So my challenge to people is, I don't think there's a single family in India which can say that in my extended family, there's nobody who has any lung issues, whether it's bronchitis or asthma or, you know, something or the other, because we are all sufferers and we don't realize this until it's too late. Like even with me, I never realized that all these years, the same thing was growing in my mother's lungs. And who knows, you know, what about the rest of our families? We don't know. It'll come out later in some different way. Mental health you're talking about. People have a lot of depression, dementia, Alzheimer's, all these diseases. Actually, there are 70,000 papers, scientific papers, air pollution to health harm. So if people take the time to pause and look at that stuff, there is not a single organ in our body which is not affected by air pollution. Because just think of it logically. You breathe in bad air. The PM2.5 goes into your lungs. It's so tiny that it gets absorbed by your bloodstream, right? And that bloodstream is going to every organ from the tips of your fingers, to the bottom of your toes, every organ of your body. And it's carrying this PM2.5 in there. What kind of damage do you think is doing? The kind of inflammatory responses and the oxidative stress that your body is going through when it is breathing bad air. I think nothing can be as pervasive as that. You know, there was a time when we did pranayam, like my father keeps telling me, you know, we used to do pranayam under a neem tree. And now I have to tell him, please don't try and even do that. Sit in your room with an air purifier and do your pranayam there. Because we can't afford to do any of these things. You know, there are so many sports people. You're a cyclist. When you go out there, at least because you're aware, you're checking for what the AQI is, how much PM2.5 is in the air. A lot of people think that by jogging, running, and all of that stuff, they are being healthy. And they would be if the air was clean. But unfortunately, they are breathing in more and more PM2.5 because they are running in such, especially in the winter. You know, I have become that crazy woman who actually stops people who are running in parks in November and December. And I tell them, don't run. You don't know what you're doing, what damage you're doing to the lungs. And they look at me like, oh my God, who is this crazy with a mask, with a double mask, who's telling me to not run? So it's become like that, you know, where you really realize how much damage people do to their lungs by just, and they think they're doing good to their body. That's what makes me so unhappy. And especially kids, you know, we tell our kids, go out and play. Don't sit and watch TV the whole day. how do they go out and play, yeah, when the air quality, when you have 612 and 412 is the reading on your PM2.5 in November, December, January. We can't. Now we are telling our children, don't go out and play. Please sit and watch TV. So, you know, it's a trade-off. You're going to get...
Yeah, you know, I mean, I remember my kids being toddlers and reading that toddlers run a full marathon every day. And I just, you know, think about a toddler growing up on, you know, on a busti near a main road or near a construction site. And, you know, during winter, what are they breathing? They don't have a chance, you know. I mean, if you think about the organ damage and the cognitive damage, and I mean, forget the diseases, they just don't have a chance. It's heartbreaking to think that, you know, how do you even overcome poverty when you have this kind of a load in your body, yeah. Right? All right. Any other questions? It's a huge privilege to be able to move. And then, of course, exodus to a place perceived to be cleaner may harm that place too. Yes, of course. You know, I think Goa and the mountains are full of people right now who have escaped. And it's also nice because you're thinking of all the cars that have left Delhi streets because all these people have left, right? So that's also there. But it is a privilege to be able to escape if you are poor and your child has breathing problems.
You know, the scary part is in India, there's another report that I read a couple of months ago, 3-4 months ago, which was, and it was done by, sponsored by CPCB, and IIT had conducted the report, which actually found that places like Kerala, Goa, and Orissa, you know, these parts of India, which are less polluted, and that's why we're running away from the more polluted to the less polluted places. They are actually, their pollution here is growing at a faster rate than is growing in Delhi. Because, you know, North India has kind of reached that plateau where how much more polluted can it get? Now, these are the more sort of, the kind of development that's happening in these places, the mining, the coal, not just the coal mining, other, you know, not and thermal power plants, other industries. So this report actually said that places like Kerala, Goa, Odisha, etc., our pollution is growing here faster. So very soon we won't even have a place to run to. Where are we going to run to? You know, right now I've been able to get to Goa to recuperate for a while, etc. But soon we won't have a place to go to. Even the mountains are becoming, and you know, in the mountains, wood fires, like mountain fires and those kind of fires, they also, there are so many causes, anything that burns, anything that combusts causes air pollution. So where are you going to run to? So that's why I think it's really important. We have an urgency. We need to have more ambitious targets, more ambitious goals, because what are we going to leave as it is? You know, climate change, somewhere there are floods, somewhere there are fires. All this is happening. What is the world we're leaving for our children? You know, and that's why when Warrior Moms started doing all this excellent work, I really applauded it because... And I still applaud it. I think it's like, this is what is needed. Unless the mothers, you know, the power of mothers comes up, because nobody is born without a mother. Unless the power of mothers comes up, I don't even think governments, corporates, no one is going to listen. Today, if all mothers said, I'm not going to buy products that are produced by polluting companies, or we're not going to allow our household to buy this stuff, we're not going to vote for people who don't give us... Nothing would, you know, that's the only way change will come. So I think more power to warrior moms. We need more warrior moms. We need warrior dads, warrior uncles. We need every sort of warrior person to get us the basic right to breathe clean air, clean water, etc.
Great. I think that's a great note to end on. Thanks so much for coming, Jyoti. And just wanted to reiterate before we end that thank you backstage for hosting us and Insta Live. And I'm with Jyoti from Care for Air. And this is her book, Breathing Here is Injurious to Your Health. Buy it. It's awesome. All right. Chalo. Bye, Jyoti.
Bye. Bye.